Right. Just to quickly recap what we did on Monday. So this book, this sort of second booklet that we're looking at, is concentrating on piano influenced music, so solo piano music, of course, but also the contribution of the song to the overall genre, or the lead, as we used to call it. Shut my skylight. It's too loud. And we looked at by Chopin, solo piano pieces, and then we looked at some more virtuosic stuff by Balakirev, a Russian composer, just a sort of brief example. And then with Leader in Song Cycles, we're looking at Robert Schumann's Dichterlieder as a sort of case study. And we're focusing on three songs in particular. We looked at the first one on Monday, in Wunderschönen Monat Mai, and looked at how the harmony paints the picture and is able to convey some of the meaning in that poetry very, very effectively in a really sophisticated manner. And then we got through to the second example was the 10th song from the cycle, where at this point the protagonist is at a, as I said, at a pretty low point, and the poetry suggests that. And the example we looked at in the music had those, you know, descending arpeggios, if you remember, like falling tears, really heavy, depressing movement in the piano accompaniment. And we again looked at some of the harmony to see how the suspensions and some of those Neapolitan chords at times are really picking out certain words, right? And that's why, for a purist, German art song will always be performed in German. It doesn't make sense to translate it, because if a composer's put a particular word or particular chord to colour a particular word, as soon as you translate that, that word might appear somewhere else in the phrase. So, of course, that music then loses its meaning a little bit. So, all this sort of art music should always be performed in the language in which it was written, really. Okay, so we're going to look at the final song before we go on, because there's another booklet for us to start today. So we're on this page on the screen here. And I mentioned this on Monday, Lieder or art songs are known to use the piano accompaniment in a very sophisticated manner. Now, the final song, the Alten Bösen Lieder, which means the old songs filled with anger, this is a real heart-wrenching close to the cycle. It is incredibly depressing, right? And the protagonist has passed through his or her range of emotions. Now, normally this cycle is sung by a man, there's nothing stopping it being sung by a woman, but obviously it was sung from the viewpoint of a man about a love for a woman. So, but you know, it can be interpreted in two ways. Now, the piano in this song is really central. I've just got a little quote here from the musicologist Lottie Lehmann. I'll read this quote out because it's really important. This is the quote about this final song, this particular song cycle. Imagine the situation. You have now passed through every stage of delight, disillusionment, bitterness. You have sought oblivion in nature, in dreams, in fantasies, which have led you away from the world of reality. So that's summing up what happened in the song cycle. All these sort of moods and all this imagery has been dealt with to reflect what's gone on in this particular story, right? You have sought, but again and again, the old torturing lovers, again, it has enslaved you. Okay? This keeps on unmuting, apologies. Now at last you decide to end this torment once and for all, if you are not to be destroyed by it. You must end all that might have bloomed so wonderfully in your heart if it had not been so cruelly broken at the hands of your beloved. The songs which you have sung in joy and sorrow must be silenced. The dreams which have tormented and comforted you must vanish. Now, That is taken from Lottie Ling, and that's coming from a programme note. So a programme note is, of course, if you go to watch a performance of this, you would have a little set of, you know, programme notes to follow through. And this is a viewpoint of a singer. This is how a singer is approaching performing this final song. Yeah? So you are utterly, your heart is literally in the audience's hands. You've poured everything out. It's an incredible display of raw emotion, right? And what's amazing about this piece and this cycle is it finishes with a piano outro, postlude, as we'd call it, which is half as long as the final song itself. So the singer's just going to stand there and let the piano finish off, right? And as I put here, it's another quote. The postlude, which is printed there for you, which looks like a piano piece in its own right, is masterfully written. You listen to its melodies as if they were memories long vanished. It can no longer give you pain because it is no longer a part of your being. It is only a sound from long ago which brings a smile to your lips, a smile of soft melancholy which can no longer wound you. Some argue that the soft melancholy in the finale, so this piano thing, reflect the singer's acceptance of peace in turning their back on their previous lover, whereas others argue that the descending arpeggios represent the singer drowning, having taken his or her own life to finally arrive at peace they've long desired and end their love-struck torment. So it's a totally over-the-top, you know, end to what has been an incredibly... you know, over the top song cycle, right? Over dramatic. The drama in this final song, it doesn't, you know, hold back. These are the words for the final song, right? So there's six stanzas, but just read that poem. This is the final song by Heinrich Heine that Schumann has included in this song cycle. The old songs filled with anger, the bad dreams filled with woe. Let's bury them now, get hold of a mighty coffin. Many the things I lay in it, but what I'll tell to none. The coffin must be greater than Heidelberg's great ton. So the great temple of Heidelberg. He's basically saying the coffin you need for me needs to be humongous because of what's going to go in it. And bring a bier as sturdy of planks and thick and strong. It must be even longer than the bridge at Mainz is long. So it's going to carry a lot of weight, he's saying. Obviously, there's imagery there. And bring 12 giants also. They must be brawnier than in his Rhine Cathedral or Cologne's St. Christopher. So he's talking about this. The imagery he's using is things that are incredibly long, like the bridge at Mainz or the cathedral at Cologne. He's trying to convey a sense of enormity here, yeah? To resemble his coffin. Bear it out and sink it beneath the deepest wave. For such a mighty coffin befits a mighty grave. Do you know why it's so heavy, so great and long and wide? I put my love and sorrow and all my pain in. Now, if that isn't a suicide note, then I don't know what is. Yeah? I thought I'd all, you know, cheer you up on a Wednesday morning. But you can see how, it's not particularly unsubtle, that poem. Right, so we're going to listen to the song, and then I'm just going to talk through that. And this amazing postlude at the end, which lasts, you know, a couple of minutes in its own right. But I've got my own views on this in terms of how I would interpret this. I think very little is left to imagination in that poem. I think it's all pretty obvious. Okay, so let's have a just quick listen to this song. So it's there, if you want to listen back to it. I'll play through here now. So this is the final song. So it's 4 minutes. Let's have a listen to it.
Einen großen Sarg hineinlegen. manches noch sag ich noch nicht was. Es sei noch grüßer, wie die Steine Berger Fass. Und holt eine Totenbarre und Bretter fest und dick. Doch groß sie sei noch länger als wie du meinst die Brück. Und holt mir auch 12 Riesen, die müssen noch stärker sein als wie der starke Christoph im Turm zu Köln am Rhein. Die sollen den Sarg forttragen und senken ins Meer hinab. Denn solchem großen Sarg ein großes Grab. Wisst ihr, warum der Sarg wohl so groß und schwer mag sein?
Das ist nicht a far more melodic phrase there. There's that sort of revealing of the emotion. And now here's the postlude. Now, for me, I'm not sure about you, but in my opinion, that is a representation at the end then of the protagonist taking their life. Yeah? That after this incredibly melodramatic love story, you've got this, he's so bereft with pain that the piano fills that story in at the end. Right? If the song would have ended there, meinen Schmerz hinein. Right? That's how big you'll need the coffin. Is that because he's ill from lovesick torment? But then we just have this sense of taking the story elsewhere from the piano. And that's why some people think, actually, is it more of a positive ending? That actually, that isn't how it ends. And Schumann gives the music more of a sort of positive aspect at the end. But the things he does here, if you think, he delays the cadence for ages. Yeah? So we have meinen Schmerz hinein. Then we have this chord. So we want to get to the home key here. So you've got five flats. We want a D flat major. So we've got that in the bottom. D flat and A flat. But the chord above it, A flat, C and E flat, A flat major, that's chord five. We want that to resolve to, we want a chord one, don't we? That's what we're after. But at the moment, we're not getting it. And he doesn't give it to us for a while. Just go back to that little bit there. So I'm listening to that bit again. So, chord five. Middle of A flat, you think? There, we expect. We expect it to finish, but no, he delays it. It takes us somewhere else. He's not allowing this to end. Right? Is that the body not submerging into the water yet? Or is it not willing to give in yet? Then we go into a new key. You can either think, yeah, that's the actual act of his suicide there in the piano postlude, or it actually turns out better. The poem ends and he sort of walks off into the distance and finally has peace with it, that it's his love that's died, not him, right? Loads of different ways you can interpret it, but you can see how much more storytelling there is in these songs and in this music in general to what we'd have had at the end of the classical era, yeah? It's far richer in that sense. There's far more going on. There's more subtext. There's more levels to it. Yeah? Something we haven't seen before, not to this extent at least. Yeah? We know we said like Mozart could word paint and stuff, but this is, you know, Schumann is working in a really sophisticated manner here. In terms of how you interpret that, there's no right or wrong, of course. Worth knowing that Schumann is. Was a chap who died in an asylum. He did actually lose his mind. Was always terribly plagued with mental health problems. And as he ended up being admitted to an asylum and finished his days there. Also had a very, very talented wife, Clara Schumann, or Clara Wieck was her maiden name. And Clara Schumann's music is tremendous. The principal of the college, when I was a student 20 years ago, and lots of you know Mrs. Penny Ryan, she still has choirs down in the Mumbles area. She was an amazing feminist, and she always used to insist that the music, if anyone phoned up Gosseinin College as it was then, that if you put on hold and you played music, it had to be by a female composer. So Clara Schumann was always her piano music that was on Gosseinin College's switchboard for years. Interesting fact for you. Interesting Schumann and Gosseinin based fact. Right. So that is that booklet there. Okay. So no analysis to do, but we've done a little bit in that. But it gives you a good summary of, I say, what's going on in terms of the detail beneath the notes. So if you now head to Google Classroom and access the new booklet, which is there, again, I put the same playlist in, is exactly the same playlist you've been using anyway. I'll be playing the music through here, of course, but you need to access that one. So this is History of Romantic Music, Opera and Music Drama. Okay, so if you're going to find that. If you can't find it, let me know. Everyone managed to get it?
Yeah.
Your normal in a page here that I always put in. Okay, this romantic music sort of collection of different styles all there. So we're looking here at, we're going to look at leitmotif, opera, and in particular, the beginnings of sort of nationalism and more word painting and so on. We're going to start with Italian opera. Now, last Monday, you saw the documentary, there were a little bit on opera at the beginning of that documentary, and it was discussing how in Italy, very little change. Now, this is important for you. We're not going to spend a lot of time looking at opera. I mean, it'll be today, this one lecture, and then we're going to sort of park it. We're not going to look at any more. Because, of course, we look at Italian music through our religious choral music when we're studying Verdi, right? Now, it's worth remembering, Verdi was first and foremost an opera composer, more than anything else. So, it's worth touching on it. Because, of course, it gives you an understanding of what was going on in the background. So Italian opera, we have seen significant developments so far. Yeah, if we think of our programme music with Berlioz and Liszt, and our, you know, expressive piano music, again, with Liszt and Chopin, and now Schumann and so on. We are seeing increased freedom and flexibility, greater amount of expression in music, and how the boundaries are being extended. The boundaries are really being pushed in all facets. So the rules are being bent with the harmony, you know, creating that extra amount of expression. Orchestra is growing. Things are evolving at a rapid pace. But, however, if it had been left to the Italian tradition, the Italian composers of the 19th century, modern music would have made it to the 20th century with very little change from the music of Mozart and Haydn. The Italians were not, as a rule, were not interested in developing music and being innovative like Berlioz and Liszt were, or Chopin, or later Wagner that we'll look at. They were happy just to knock out singable, nice, pleasant tunes that people could, you know, sing themselves, hum along to. You know, their main objectives were totally different. It says here, opera was the pop music of its time. And more than just popular, everyone in Italy went to opera and knew all the tunes from the latest arias and choruses. Right? So the intentions of the Italian operatic composers is money, ticket revenue. They want to fill the opera houses with loads and loads and loads of customers, loads of punters. So you don't want to challenge them, and you don't want to make your listeners think. You just want to give them a nice night at the opera. Give them a few tunes that they're going to enjoy, they're going to remember. Yeah, a couple of rousing choruses, a couple of sad arias, a couple of funny little duets, like a normal variety, you know, that you'd expect in any sort of opera or musical nowadays, right? And of course, we have that nowadays. If you think of our musical theatre tradition in the West End and in Broadway, there are some shows which are very, you know, which are great shows, and they're just there to entertain the audience. You know, things like the jukebox musicals, Mamma Mia, We Will Rock You. They're there to give the audience a good night. Yeah, things like Hairspray. You know, nothing too deep in the storyline. It just gives us a nice story, it's a nice night out. But there are musicals out there as well which challenge us a bit more. You know, things like, you know, Hamilton to an extent. Yes, it's entertaining because the music is very, very, you know, engaging. But the storyline's a little bit grittier. Things like, if you take some of Jason Robert Brown's musicals. Now, some of you might know what I'm on about because you're into musical theatre. If you think of musicals like The Last 5 Years, The Last 5 Years is a really famous musical that was made into a film a little while back. It only came out about 15 years ago. But there's only two characters in that musical. And it's about a 5-year relationship. And it's a breakup. So we have the story from the first date to the divorce, all in 5 years. And the woman's story is told in reverse. And the man's story is told in chronological order. So the musical starts with the girl at the end of the relationship in that very famous song, Still Hurting, which I know lots of you will be familiar with. And then as the musical progresses, she goes back in time. So she ends the musical on the first date. So the only time is when the two characters cross over is in the middle of the show, which is the wedding. Yeah. So of course that's a little bit more difficult to follow. And it's, you know, it's challenging the listener in a bit more, right? It's trying to be a bit more innovative with the genre. If we scale back now 150, 170, and 200 years, the Italians were doing just pay lip service to the audience, just giving good tunes, plenty of, you know, just keep them, just treat your audience to nice things. Don't challenge them too much. The challenge was happening north of the Alps in Germany and so on, right? As a result, there were a huge number of operas being written. So singable tunes poured out of composers such as Bellini, Rossini, and then, of course, Verdi, who we're going to look at a lot next year. And Verdi wrote 28 operas over a 51-year period. An incredibly important output. And, you know, we associate opera with Italy, and it's in this century, really, that the Italians really, you know, staked their claim for that. And I just put a few things there in bold. So music in this genre was accessible and therefore simply and carefully composed, much like the music of the late classical era. So it goes back to that point. If it was left to the Italians, you know, very little development would have happened. They weren't interested in pushing the boundaries forward. We're just going to look at an example here from Donizetti, Guillermo Donizetti. And his opera, L'Elisir d'Amour. And this comes from the beginning of the Romantic era. So we're looking at 1832, right? Right, we're looking at the Romantic era, sort of from 1830 to around the turn of the 20th century up to about 1910. So we're right to the beginning of the era. But bear in mind that Symphonie Fantastique, that crazily innovative five-movement symphony that we looked at last week by Berlioz, was written in 1830. So already in France, Berlioz is starting to, you know, think about music of the future and pushing things forward. Donizetti, in Italy, things are still very much traditional at this point, right? And what we'll notice here, we're going to look at this aria, Una Furtiva Lagrima, and I've annotated this video so you can see how simple it is. Right, so let's have a listen to this. I'm just going to listen to that intro again, but it's so simple, right? What we've heard is 9 bars. We had a 1-bar introduction just to set up, as I put there, the key. And in this case, we're in B flat minor. Okay. And then we have, like in a classical style, a little 2-bar phrase given to us, with the dominant and the tonic, we have this. Yeah? One, five. That two bar, if you think if Haydn was writing it, what would he do with that two bar phrase? He'd balance it with another two bar phrase. And that's exactly what the composer does. He gives us an answering phrase, up a tone, so he just gives us a sequence. The first one, we have, yeah, up a tone. And rather than it being chord one to chord five, he now gives us chord five, five, one. A perfectly balanced two-bar phrase followed by another two-bar phrase. Yeah? Then, as I put there, we have an A-flat creeping in. Now, of course, we've had A natural so far, which would put this in the minor key. And here we have... takes us to that relative major, briefly, D-flat. Come on, don't be silly. And then we finally return to... da-da-da-da. Then we have this final two bars of the phrase to balance up that. B-flat, D-flat with the F in the bass. That's chord one in its seconded version, so that's 1C. F, A, C, D-flat, 5-7, chord 5, 1. So 1C, 5-7, 1. A typical classical cadence. And it brings that opening 8-bar phrase, that perfect symmetry. Two bars, balanced by two bars, balanced by four bars. The typical Italian melody in the same style as what Mozart and Haydn would have written. Just listen to that opening again. Is that 2+2? No, the 4-bar phrase, the balance. Yeah. What is interesting about that opening, you might think, well, that could be written by Mozart or Haydn. There's nothing different there at all. What, if you want to unmute, are the instruments? What orchestration has he chosen? The strings are the main beat of the bar. What's playing that plucked? What played it anyway? Harp? What's playing the melody?
Clarinet?
No.
Oboe.
Not a oboe. Just look at where it starts. Too low. A bassoon playing towards the top of its range. So we've got, I guess, a bassoon and harp duet, really. Right? Now that is a little bit different. So the availability of the harp and the availability of these different instruments, that's going to give us a different type of sound, and that places this music in this era rather than the classical era, right? But if you think, I say, harmonically, it's all chord one and five, pretty much, and the melodies are entirely balanced like Haydn would have been. It's only the orchestration that gives it away. For a second. So what we've got there, as I annotated, tenor soloist, who in this recording is Luciano Pavarotti, excuse the typo there, the tenor solo repeats that opening 8-bar melody. So the Donizetti said, right, I've got that 8-bar melody, I'm going to repeat it straight away. I've introduced it with the oboe and the harp, and now I'm going to give it to the tenor. Una furtiva lagrima. Okay, so what was originally presented by the soon, we now have in the tenor, and I put, notice the mini echoes from the clarinet at the end of each 2-bar phrase. Yeah? Una furtiva lagrima. Da-da-da. Just a little bit of imitation. Nothing exciting, but just gives it a little bit of interest. Yeah? Well, it was in higher range of the bassoon, you know, towards the top of the tenor range as well, that top A flat, very expressive. How would you describe that note there? We have this. That E flat doesn't match that chord at all. We've got D flat, F, A flat. And we've got an E flat. And then it moves up to an F. If you were to give that a term, what would it be?
Suspension?
If it was a suspension, what would it need before it? It would need to be prepared, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
If there was an E flat before the bar line, definitely it would be a suspension. But it's not prepared, so what do we call it? It's actually an Italian term we give this, a certain ornament name. A double P.
Appoggiatura.
Yeah, that's what it is. And not just an appoggiatura, but a chromatic appoggiatura, because there's that accidental on it. Yeah, if it was just a normal E flat, it would have been. Yeah? But we have those little touches, and we do get that in Mozart, so that's nothing particularly new. You can see that influence the late classical period is there. And there's that difference there. We had before. Now we've got. We finish on chord 5, because we've got an imperfect cadence here. And there's that diminished 7th chord that I've illustrated there. E natural, G natural, B flat, D flat. All a minor third apart, yeah? Going up to that chord 5. The next bit that follows, just have a listen to this. So that little bit there, as I put here, having reached that chord 5, that F just stays now in the bass, doesn't it? So it becomes a pedal, or as we know, a dominant pedal. If we're in B flat minor, that F is chord 5. If I just play those semi favours. Yeah, so it's 5, 1, 5, 1, 5. Just those two chords, but the F remains as a pedal. Thinking we're going to be moving to that tonic B flat at the bass at some point pretty soon. But again, everything's working in sort of very mathematically even sections, like the classical era. So we have, first of all, the bassoon, da 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 da, imitated by the tenor. Then the oboe. Ba, 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 ya, da, da. Then he sings da 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 da. Another 2-bar phrase. So we've got, you know, 2-bar phrases, 4-bar phrases, everything's working together like a really, really clever and rigid jigsaw. Yeah? Everything's got to be very, very even in how it's spaced out. But, as I've said here, finally we get this this full bar here. There's our chord five, so we're expecting our chord one. But look at where he takes us. He takes us to D flat major. Now we know that's the relative. B flat minor and D flat is we've gone to the relative major. But really, if we wanted to get there, we should have had a chord five there. Yeah? So we're seeing there's an unusual key change there. Yeah, there's a little bit of freedom, not a lot, because we're still dominated by chords 1, 4, and 5. But you know, we've got that he just uses that F as a consistent note, as a sort of pivot note, as I put there, and takes us into that new key with very little warning. He doesn't prepare it in the same way by, you know, making sure he's got the right leading note and making sure he's got the right chord five. He just sort of melts away into it differently. Yeah, it's a bit different to what we're normally expecting. Just listen to that bit again. Five take us back into an original key. Yeah? But look at those chords in that once he's got to D flat major there. So that ma ma chord one. Then C ma ma chord four. Next bar. 1 C 5 1. He's dominated by the primary chords. Yeah? If you compare that to what we've listened to with Schumann, right, and I know that's, you know, about 10 or so years after this, but Berlioz wrote his Symphonie Fantastique before this. This is very, very traditional, still quite conservative. So listen to that opening section again. One bar, and then third, part of three. Balanced lead by the answer in bars. Collectively, those four bars need four bars to balance. This is going to be good. To the musical material from that open vocal section. So those 8 bars we had previously, you liked them, let's repeat them. New stanza. I'm also put here, notice how the harmonic rhythm is very regular and steady throughout. Yeah, it's one chord per bar, or one, two or two chords per bar. Very, very simple. So, really expressive moment here. That chord F before, if you remember, it slid into D flat. This time, change of key signature, we're going to go to 2 flat, B flat major. So we're going to, not B flat minor, B flat major this time, but that chord has acted as a dominant seventh, this chord, this time. So we've gone, as we call it, the tonic major. The tonic has stayed the same, but we're in the major key rather than the minor key. So as he went to the unusual D flat major earlier on, he's gone to where we expect here. Okay, and really expressive harmony. The aria ends now with this expressive cadenza. Now, obviously, cadenza is something we associate with instrumentalists, yeah? Things that only happen in concertos where they improvise. There's this long sort of extensive trill, but what singers tend to do when they perform this is they add more, yeah? And when they're done, they finish on a pause note and the piano will come back in with them. So just listen to Pavarotti's cadenza here. He sings these notes, but then he adds a bit more. Non chiedo si può morir. A very improvisatory in style. Si può morir. Chord one, chord five, chord one, chord five, chord one. Okay. Very, very traditional. Yeah. Yes, it's only at the start of the era. So fair enough. You know, perhaps the innovative ways haven't reached them yet. But you can see in Italy, no different from that classical era. Dominated by chords one, four, and five. Even balanced phrases, singable melodies. There's only a couple of things that place this in the Romantic era. The orchestration is a little bit more original, and there was just that one little key change that added a little bit of ingenuity about it. Okay. So that's how I've summed that up there in your booklet as well. Notice how many of the harmonic, melodic and textural features. It's all homophonic, isn't it? There's no polyphony, nothing rich in the orchestration at all, right? This is understandable as in 1832, the Romantic era is in its infancy. I've made that comparison with Berlioz again. Compare the features of this aria with the following excerpt for soprano solo and male chorus from Verdi's La Forza del Destino, The Force of Destiny. So we're going to look at a a Verdi example from 1862. So, you know, we're 30 years into the Romantic era now. So you would imagine the expectation, as I put here, that the influences from the Romantic era would now have been absorbed into the Italian operatic tradition. But when we listen to it, we'll notice that this is definitely not the case, right? What I would like you to do, I'm going to play it a few times, and I want you to complete this table underneath. So comment on the following musical elements and how they are executed in the excerpt. So how is harmony and tonality executed? What types of chords do we have? What's the harmonic rhythm like? Do we have any interesting chords? Do we have any interesting key changes? Do we not have any key changes at all? Right? That's the type of thing I'm after there. For the melody, I want to hear about phrase length, the range, rhythm. Okay? Any devices, repetition, imitation, sequence. Okay? And then texture. What type of textures do we have? Is there any counter melodies? We've got a number of layers here. We've got a soprano soloist and a male chorus. Right? So we've got two tenor parts, a sort of baritone and a bass part, plus a solo soprano. There's enough layers there to have some interest. It's not just an aria. We've got five vocal lines. Are we going to expect to see some polyphonic writing? Are we going to see unison writing? Or is it just going to be very, very simple homophonic writing, like a hymn? Right? So some comments about the texture there and any sort of dialogue or conversation or antiphony we might have. Okay? So I'll play this three times and I'll give you some time to finish it off. Here we go. I'm just going to make sure you're all muted. I think most of you are. Okay, here we go. Here it comes again, right? So think, give bar numbers as well if you can, with things like phrase length, and if there's any changes to textures or anything you notice that's different, or any key changes and such, try and get some bar numbers if you can, right? One thing, I think the first bar is sort of missed out on the recording. So you get the idea, they'll be very similar to the previous one. You'll have this sort of one bar to set the key up. Here we go. Okay, I'm going to play it once more, and then I go through some findings, right? But try and get as much detail down in your booklets as you can, all right?
Thank you.
Okay. I'm just going to mute some of you guys. Give me 2 seconds. I'm going to try and... I've had a look through some of your answers. Some good observations on the whole. So, of course, we have this opening one bar, say, sets up the keys. So we're in G major. Okay? So if we just do harmony and tonality first, we've got chord 1, chord 4, and then we have a sort of... this chord here, E, G sharp, and B. You think, well, that's a bit odd. If we've got an E with that G sharp, if we treat that as an E denote, does that mean we're sort of in A minor there? Possibly, if we've sort of gone to A minor, the supertonic. But then in the next bar, we're straight back into G major. So we've got chord 1, chord 5, chord 1, chord 4, 1, C, 5, 5, 1. It's still very much in a classical style, isn't it? Harmonically, right? And if I just look through that accompaniment part, there's that one accidental there in the accompaniment, and then it's corrected. But other than that, there's nothing. There's no chromaticism. It's all very, very, very obvious, right? If you look at the melody of that opening 8 bars, we have a 4-bar phrase balanced by a second 4-bar phrase. Nice and simple. Yes, the phrases appear quite long because it's such a slow moving excerpt. Yeah, it's a slow adagio, this one. So of course it's making, you know, that gives the impression that the phrase is quite long, but they're still very, very even. Yeah. And that opening phrase, very, very limited range. That doesn't look like a romantic melody to me, soaring anywhere. The next one, possibly. Oi, protege, vigile. It's all broken chords. Da 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 da. You know, a sort of rising arch shaped melody starting on the B, D, G, E, da 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 da. Goes up and then comes down. So, typical melody, really. Okay. You've got that double dotted rhythm that's there. If you think of the texture, it's entirely homophonic, homorhythmic even. Every single part is sharing the same rhythm of that male chorus. Yeah, it's like a hymn, like a chorale underneath. Very church-like. Okay. We do have a little bit of interest that we've got triplets cutting against the flow there. It's that double dotted rhythm, but nevertheless, that's what it is. Soprano soloist comes in and she sings exactly the same as what the tenors have sung in that opening 8-bar vocal melody. So he's given us 4 bars, balanced with 4 bars. He then repeats that 8-bar phrase, entirely balanced. Yeah? No changes to harmony at all. Musically, it's an exact repeat. Then the end of that little section, so the last beat of bar 17, the choir give us something different. They give us this. So we sort of go into A minor briefly, then we go into E major, but then we're back. We're back into our normal G major key there later on. Okay. So very, very simple. Those moves are not going to sort of any sort of alien keys. We're only going to A minor and so on. Melodically, it's still a 4-bar phrase. La Vergine degli Angeli, 2 bars repeated with Mi copra del suo manto, 2-bar phrase there. Balanced. And then we get the 4-bar phrase that ended the first section. E voi proteggia vigile l'angiol di Dio. Another 4-bar phrase. Balanced, classical in the shape. The only difference we get is that we have this sort of echo in the soprano part, a bar after the tenors, which gives us a little bit of interest. La Vergine, La Vergine degli Angeli. So there's a little bit of canon there. Mi copra del suo man e me protegga me. But then she sort of falls into the rhythm that the male choir is singing. Right? So it doesn't happen for very long. And other than that, texturally, everything is still being shared in terms of those rhythms. Yeah? Then, different little section here. We've got this. Those four bars, chord four, but a minor version of chord four. So a little bit more, you know, of a change that we would have had normally. But a four bar phrase nonetheless. Then another four bar phrase, L'angelo di Dio me protegga. There's that E major chord once more. So back into A minor, but then we come into perfect cadence into G major, but another four bar phrase. And the final phrase is just an arpeggio. E me prote, G, B, D, G. And there's a little E flat of that C minor chord that we had coming in for a final four bars at the end. But it's as if he's measured the bars out. Yeah? As if he's measured them out. And you think, right, I've got a four bars there, then it's going to be down to eight, then I'm going to repeat that, then I'm going to have another four bars, then I'm going to have another four bars, then another four. It's all entirely balanced melodically. The phrases are so even. Harmony was still dominated by our primary chords in the main. Any key changes we have are to related keys, and we're not there for very long. And even when we do go to those keys, we remain in using the primary chords, 1 and 5 predominantly. The range of the melodies aren't particularly extensive. Yeah, and they've got a very, very obvious shape about them, very, very singable, very hummable. Proper little earworm, and textually it's extremely simple. Yeah, very, very homophonic, bit like a hymn really. And in the background you've just got those triplets. So simple, right? So going back to the comment I made at the end of the previous page, you would expect that Verdi would have pushed music on a little bit from Donizetti 30 years before him. It hasn't happened. The Italian tradition is about conservatism and tradition. Things the same, right? Keep things the same. Let's not push anything too far. We've got an audience to cater to, right? Those are the intentions of the composers. Right. Tomorrow, guys, we'll finish this booklet off. So we'll do that at 11 tomorrow to make up for what we missed yesterday. So we'll meet at 11 tomorrow and we'll look at music dramas and Wagner. All right? Need anything in the meantime, give me a shout.
Thank you.
No problem. Thank you.